My name is Elsie Paul. I'm 77 years old. I was born on a Métis settlement 77 years ago, you know, one of the dissolved Métis settlements. But I ended up in my mom's reserve in Saddle Lake when I was 2 years old. So to me, the celebration of, Louis Riel Day is real important because some of us are still going through the difficulty, Louis Riel. But he was so incredible. I feel so honored to be here for him, you know, to be part of the celebration because I really honor and respect him. And I found out he also wrote a prayer because he was very spiritual also, you know, and I would like to read that because every time I go to events and do things, we do smudging and always we start with a prayer. And, you know, Métis, mixed bloods, you know, so, and some of us do both of those, you know, ways of doing life. And when I found this prayer of Louis Riel, I was so, felt so excited. Prayer of the Council, 1885. Lord our God, thou art the Father of mercy and consolation. We are several French-Canadian Métis gathered together in council who put our confidence in thee. Grant that we may not be covered with confusion. Ever defend us from this. Enlighten us in our darkness of doubt. Encourage us in our trail. Strengthen us in our weakness and sour us in the time of pressing need. By Louis Riel. I thought that was such an incredible thing that he left behind for us, you know. And I found it last night. That's not an accident. I needed to do it here, I guess, you know. So I feel really honored by that. So therefore, you know, every year I try and help different people to celebrate Métis Days because it's so important that we do that because the Métis culture is as rich as the Indigenous culture. They both have, you know, a beautiful way of life, you know. So in my recovery, I began to learn about, you know, Métis and Indigenous culture, and that's what's helping me in my journey right now. You know, culture makes you who you are, you know. So I'm so grateful that I'm a Cree Métis and I'm proud of that. I come from the best of the both worlds, you know. Our Indigenous people have symbolic meanings, like with the eagle feather, when nature's our teacher. Well, this sash also has teachings, and it's important we teach the younger generation about this. This had multi-purposes uses. The voyageurs, when they came here, they brought the sash with them. It was usually about 3 meters long, you know. It had multi-uses for it. Sometimes it was really strong. It was about 3 meters long, you know. Sometimes they would use it as a rope. They'd pull their canoes with it, you know, and these were really long also, you know, so they would cut them up and use them for string when they have to tie something, you know. So it had multi-purposes with it, you know. You know, you could use it as a scarf, a belt, you know, a face warmer. And sometimes they would put it like this and they would put a really heavy load in the back and lift things with that. You know, my grandpa used to tell us about that. You know, there is a name for it, but I can't remember what the name of that is. Senior moments. I forget sometimes these things, you know. But anyway, like, and all these colors have meanings, just like the Cree have their colors, the meanings, you know, so do the Métis people, you know. And the red here represents the blood that they shed historically fighting for their rights, you know, for the land and their culture and stuff like that. So that's the blood that they shed. And the green is the fertility of Métis Nation, you know. And the white means their spirituality to the Creator, because they were very strong Catholics, you know, a lot of Catholic people. Nothing wrong with that. It's still like the elder said in one of those videos, one mind, one spirit. You know, everybody has different religion, It's just one spirit, you know. So that's their spiritual connection to the Creator, you know. And this, the blue, that's the pride of Métis people. It's real important we teach the children, the younger generation, to have pride as Métis people, not to grow up ashamed of who they are, you know. And even Indigenous people, they have Indian pride with the blue. That has a meaning too, you know. So Métis people have these colors. And the yellow is the fertility of the Métis people. And sometimes you'll see black on there. That represent the dark time that our people went through, like the hanging of Louis Riel. That was very difficult journey for our people. And it still is when you hear about it, when you learn about it, that Louis Riel got hung. You know, they didn't have to hang him. He was fighting for the inherent right for his people. He was a leader, you know. And so it had multi-uses. Sometimes I see people, they put the sash across, like a necks like this, and they do the Red River jig on there, you know, and that's so neat, you know. And so Métis women are using the sash now too. And for me, modern day sash, I made myself, because we have to wear masks now all the time. I made myself a mask, you know, it's Métis sash, you know. So, and then I told the people, I says, and when I take it down, it keeps my neck warm, you know. But because of the multi-uses of the sash, it also covers up the wrinkles of my neck. So that's the modern day sash for me, you know. So we're still using this sash. It's really important, you know. So therefore, and it was, they used to make these themselves, you know. They'd weave it, you know. And in one of the history books, when I was reading it, when they didn't have the wool to do it, they would use plants to weave the sash, you know. And the Indigenous people had sashes too, but they wore it differently, you know. So therefore, but the Voyageurs brought this kind of a sash when they came here, you know. So therefore, it's real important. And I've been teaching this sash for a long, long time for the younger generation. And one time for the, you know, the kids, I cut the paper, you know, I made a bunch of holes. I gave them the colors of the yarn and they weaved it up. And I was talking to them about the meaning of the sash, you know. So we need to really teach the younger generation, you know, it has a lot to do with culture. It's a very important, and you know, when you begin to know your culture, and both for me, I learned about the Cree culture and the Métis culture. When they give you the eagle feather, you feel so honored and good. When they give you the sash, that same feeling goes into your heart, you know, because it's really, I feel honored when people give me a sash, just like as they give me an eagle feather, you know. Our culture is so rich, and we're so lucky when we're Métis, because we come from the Indigenous culture and the Métis culture. It could be English or else Scottish or French or whatever. And I've done my genealogy, and my ancestral grandfathers were born in Quebec, and that's the other one I want to honor right now, because you can find him on the computer. His name is Paulette Paul. And he's in a history book too, so I really honor him like I'm honoring Louis Riel right now. They participated in their community a long time ago. So when they left, a lot of lessons for us, even though they're gone, we're still learning a lot from all of them, like Louis Riel. He taught us so many things about bravery, generosity, leadership, you know, everything, all of that, even though he's not alive right now. But the way he was on this earth, you know, he did a lot so good. And we're learning. He left his gifts behind, you know, and he was very spiritual. He wanted to be a priest, you know. He really believed in the Creator, you know. And so therefore, they are so incredible teachers and leaders and helpers and, you know, healers. You know, I'll never forget their, to me, I'm not going to forget who they are right now. And so I've learned these, you know, we have our own Métis flags, you know, which is real important to teach our younger generation. And I used to wonder why this one is blue and the other one is red. I didn't know why that was. And later on, I found out The blue is the one that aligned themselves with their French ancestry behind, you know, they had, their fathers was from France, you know, and the red is from England, you know. They aligned themselves with the English people. And so that's why the two colors. And of course, this here thing, you know, the Métis infinity sign, that's a meaning too, that the cultures came together. You know, it's a combination of different cultures. First, it was the voyagers that came here. They settled with our Aboriginal people, you know, and our women, you know. Like one elder said, 9 months after the voyagers landed in Canada, there was Métis Nation was born, you know, because they had babies and they're called mixed bloods. You know, when I was taking Machif language, the instructor there was telling him how much I honored the buffalo and everything. The next day he brought me 2 buffalo jaws, bones here. And I thought, oh, what am I going to do with that? So I cleaned them. Then I was sitting there thinking about our Métis culture and all that, you know. And so I decided to start drawing on it. The history of Métis people. And as you see right here, there's the teepee right here, and there's a woman here, and there's the voyager on a York boat, and they're both going like this, because I learned from our indigenous culture, there was always welcoming of the visitors. And so I thought, since the voyagers settled with the Aboriginal women, she's waving at him and he's waving at her. So I thought, okay, I'll do it that way. This is their journey historically through here. They invented the Red River card because of the well-organized buffalo hunt, you know, and all of that. And there's the buffalo and, of course, the fiddle over here and these 2 flags just to honor the, you know, some aligned themselves with their English background. Their dads came from England, you know. And then this one for the French and all that. This is just to show, you know, you can do a teaching just from anything. And last year I talked about Métis teachings briefly. I'm not an expert. I don't know everything. I only know very little because I've only been in recovery for 33 years. But the buffalo. Oh man, I feel really connected to buffalo. That's my animal spirit, I feel. When I'm at Métis Crossing, I take my drum out and I sing for the buffalo because they're so important. They helped us survive on this land for thousands of years for the Aboriginal people. And when Métis people ended up being here, they also relied their livelihood on the buffalo. So we can't forget the buffalo. They are such, they've made our people, both Aboriginal and Métis people, survive here on this land for so many years. And I honor the buffalo, I respect them. They're my relatives, I say, you know. That's what I sing on my song for them. And so when Métis people came here, their culture was rich. They went together with the Aboriginal people, you know, and stuff. They learned a lot from the Aboriginal people, and Aboriginal people learned a lot from the voyagers also. So they, you know, shared that teachings together, and they were able to survive here and stuff like that. So therefore, it's real important. But then the settlers started coming in more and more, you know, and our people that claimed their land, Métis people that claimed their land, process, and our Aboriginal people, the Métis people started being pushed and pushed. The government kept getting them off the land. And to the point where they were known as road allowance people because they ended up in the ditches because they had nowhere to live. They couldn't live on the reserves because they're not status, you know. And then when that land was taken from one place to the other, they kept being moving. They finally ended up in Alberta, you know. And so they were known as road allowance people. I can kind of relate to that because I'm Bill C. 31. When I became treaty, I lost my land again in Kikino Métis settlement. I'm landless in my own country. I don't have no land base anywhere. So I can kind of relate what the Métis people must have felt when they were ending up in the ditches. They had nowhere to go. And when I was 2 years old, it repeated with my mom and dad. We had to leave because the government took over four of those settlements, and one of them I was born. We had nowhere to go, so we had to go to my mom's reserve in Saddle Lake, you know. And I stayed there till I was 16 years old. So, but I didn't know anything about my culture till I became problematic in the city here. I was a psycho mom, an alcoholic, and a drug addict. So therefore, I was still impacted, even though I'm intergenerational, I was still impacted by the residential school impact, even though I didn't go to residential school. I lost my kids through child welfare. That was trauma, you know? But I had to sober up because they told me if I didn't straighten out, I was gonna lose my kids forever. And that's what got me into my journey. And so I ended up hooking up into my Aboriginal culture in my sobriety. And I will stay there because that's so beautiful. It keeps me clean. It keeps me on that wellness journey. Both cultures do that for me. I'm not ashamed anymore being a cream AT. I am proud of who I am, and that's what culture. I'm really thankful to the Cree elders and the Métis elders for teaching me who I am, you know, because it keeps me straight on this wellness journey. And the more I hook into it, the more I heal, the more I feel better of who I am. And so I am, you know, now I do different things in the community. This is a coloring book I'm working for the little elders, I call them, the little kids, you know. Elsie Paul's coloring book, it says. I'm just working on it right now, you know. So therefore, and I even do a different definition of the Métis, as you can see. And you know, this is my own definition of how I put the Métis word down. M stands for Made in Canada. E is for they're electrified, you know. T is for they're totally tolerant. I is for inspirational. S is for spirits. That's my terminology of Métis, because that's how I see us as Métis people, you know. And the Red River card, this is a very important part of our Métis culture, because the Métis people invented the Red River card. It isn't just the Red River. When they had well-organized buffalo hunts, you know, and they would load down this with a lot of buffalo meat and hide and everything. And so it was really, they would travel with this 12 to 1500 carts at the time, you know. And then when they had to cross the river, they took the wheels off and it became a raft. They could cross the river with it. We need to teach that to the little kids. And of course, when they met, it's all made out of nature, like wood and stuff like that. And they learned from their Aboriginal people rawhide. They would wrap it around the wheels. And that's what made that noise so noise. When it was 1,200, 1,500 Red River carts, if they're going, they would make a lot of noise. One elder said, it was the sound of the Red River jig. It was beautiful, he said, you know. So, but that's how they put the rawhide. And our people, Indigenous people, used rawhide in so many ways. They even made drums. So they wrapped it around the wheel of the Red River cart. And so our Métis people are so incredibly creative too. They did that Red River cart, you know. So it isn't just the Red River cart, you know. So therefore, it's really incredible. And the York boat, I haven't drawn that yet. That's another one that they did, you know. And my grandpa, he was a tribesman. He used to deliver the supplies to Fort Edmonton and back to Manitoba, you know, and that was his job long time ago, the one that I talked about, you know. So therefore, the York boat was also invented by Métis people, you know. So therefore, they have their own lifestyle, their way, their traditions, their values, their spirituality is different from Aboriginal people, but it has similarities, you know, and stuff like that. It's very rich. you know. Their own dances, like we'll be doing Red River Jig today too, you know. And you'll be able to see the regalia, Métis regalia, we'll call it. Like Aboriginal people have, they call it regalia, their stuff. There's Métis ones too. They had their own clothing, their own coats, you know. Their own style of beadwork is different than Métis culture, you know. The Cree style of beadwork, you know, it's a little bit different when you're around it all, that you can tell, oh, that's Cree beadwork, that one is Métis, you know. You can tell the difference. But they were really impressed by the nuns. They used to use silk thread, and that's what they started making the flowers with it, you know. And so there later on the beads came, and they used that too, just like the Cree people, you know. So therefore, like I say, we can never take our animals for granted. We have to honor, and we were taught long time ago by our indigenous people that we have to honor and respect the animals because they keep us alive, you know. And the buffalo, I just love the buffalo. To me, I love the meat. It's so delicious, you know. And our people had well-organized buffalo hunts, which they learned about their Aboriginal relatives too, you know, how to do that. So the combination of the both cultures were so good. If you can just imagine that this buffalo, look at all the things we get from the buffalo. It isn't just the buffalo, you know. The horns, you can make cups and spoons, ornaments and powder, and you know, powder horns and all that. The skull was used for ceremony, you know, which they learned from Aboriginal people too, you know. So, and so therefore the hair was padding and ornaments. You could make it out of that. Sinew, I have some of that, but from a deer that I learned how to make that, you know. So therefore, we had our own thread. It came from the buffalo too, just like the deer and the moose and all that. The bone, we get foods, knives, ornaments, all from this animal. The hide, the clothing, you know, the containers, because I even saw a bag that was made from the inside of the buffalo, you know. It was so incredible. Teepees were made out of that, you know. So our Aboriginal people learned so much how to get from the animals, and our Métis people also learned. It was passed on to them by the Aboriginal people, you know. So we need to really, even the buffalo chips, you know, even the bones I learned, they when they sugarize something, they get it from the bones of the buffalo. I couldn't believe that, you know. The tail was used for ceremonies, and this one, I won't mention that one, the organs, food containers, meat roasted, boiled, and you know, and they learned that, they call it pemmican. They went into a pemmican war with the Hudson Bay. Our Métis people were selling pemmican. The great pronunciation is pemmican. That's the Cree way of pronouncing that, you know. And they learned that from their Aboriginal mothers, pemmican. So they were selling it to the settlers when they were coming. They were making money. So Hudson Bay didn't want the Métis people to be making money, so they went into a skirmish with the Métis because they were fighting for their right to earn their living by selling that food that they learned from our indigenous community, you know. And I made some of that. It's very delicious, you know. You crush the dry meat into a powdery state. You put berries and grease in it. And that's what they were selling, you know, to the settlers. They were making a living out of it. So the hoofs, they made rattles out of it. We had our own crazy glue. I say we invented crazy glue because they would boil the horns and the hoofs and boil them. And that came like a glue after. You know, I say we created crazy glue, you know, a long time ago. That you can make it out of the horns and the hoofs. You can make glue out of that, you know. So the beard and the ornaments, moose hair tufting, you can use that, you know, from the moose too. So many things, the tongues, the inner organs were all so good. We were told never to throw away, to eat everything. like us to honor and respect the animals. That's our way. Even West Coast people do that. They put the bones into the ocean. They say that's their relatives. You know, our people has so many ways of honoring the plants, Mother Earth, and animals. We need to teach our younger generation all of those. If we do, even the sacredness of water, you know. So therefore, things are not just things that are on this, on Mother Earth, you know. Everything is so sacred.
Change.